You're gonna have to work the button back there. Our sermon is I Am, based off the gospel lesson is read this Trinity Sunday at the beginning of prayer. Lord, open our hearts to you now. Let your presence come. Let us walk with you and serve you. Let us live in your love. May we rejoice, Lord, for you are God. And Lord, you are all that we need and all that we are and all that we could want. Help us, Lord, to see that and rejoice in it. Amen. I have a set of CDs in my home, and there are famous speeches throughout the world. There's Ronald Reagan's speech on, you know, Gorbachev, tear down this wall. It's John F. Kennedy's speech on, that's not what your country can do for you, but that's what you can do for your country. There's FDR on there saying, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. There's some really great speeches, words that literally impacted the whole world. Winston Churchill was on there. A lot of these great famous people are there, but if we really had a collection of the most world-shaking words and speeches, then this statement would be on there. Before Abraham was, I am. You and I can't even begin to understand how earth-shaking that was for Jesus to say that in that day at that time. How absolutely unbelievable to the Jews that someone would say, I am. Because I am was the name of God. Next one. It literally was the name that God gave to Moses to tell the people of Israel. We read from Exodus. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to the Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be a sign to you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. And Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your father has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and the name you shall call me from generations to generations. I am is a name that God gave himself. There's all kinds of names for God in the Bible. Jehovah, Elohim, Elohim, Creator, Savior, Rose of Sharon, Rock, Lamb of God, on and on and on. We can come up with lots of names that the Bible calls God. In fact, there's a poster in my office there on all the different names, and there's like 40 of them. But every name that we have on our poster, every name, other name besides this one, is ones that man made up to call God. That man describes him as God. It is man who calls him Father. And of course God is Father. There's nothing wrong with that. But when God is asked his name, when God says his name, God says, I am. That is the name that God chose. That is the name that God says, this is my name. I am. I am the present. I am the past. I am the future. Doesn't matter. I am here, I am there, I am wherever. No matter how big we are, no matter how small we are, no matter how old we are, no matter how young we are, no matter where we are, I am there. I am. When we're looking for answers, I am. When we're wondering where to turn, I am. When we want to know who created us and where the world came from, et cetera, I am. Literally, when Jesus says, I am, He is saying that I am everything. He is everything. And I mean everything. That he is all of God. When we see Jesus, we see the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We see all of God. And we want to know who God is. All we do is study Jesus. I am. Omniscient. Omnipresent. All-knowing. All-powerful. Everything. I am. Describes it all. And then Jesus goes on and defines that even more. And he finds that there's eight different I am's in the New Testament. We're going to deal with just one of them. I am the way, the truth, and life. He begins to say, I am the truth. I am the truth. Not, I am one of the truths. I am the truth. This is what Mike talked about in his workshop today on biblical worldview. I am it. I am the only truth. Today we get told all kinds of things are true. We get told that we have to accept all kinds of things today. Whether it be transgender and all that garbage that's going on now, whether it be the homosexual marriage, whether it be the fact that you are totally here by chance and you were created from whatever you evolved from. Reality is that there is only one truth. If Jesus is God, Jesus is I am, then there is only one truth. There's not lots of them. There's one. And either we believe that truth, either Jesus says this is the truth, and it's true, or God's lie. Jesus lie. It's your choice. There's no in between. There really isn't. We can't try to meld the world's views and what we're being taught right and left with God's word. God doesn't give us that option. I am the truth. All of the truth. I am the answer. What is the truth God gives us? I picked three. I picked a bunch of them. But I picked three to talk about. A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus reached out his hand and he touched the man. I am willing, he said, be clean. And immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. The truth is God cares for us. I really care. This man comes up, if you are willing. I am. I am. I want to heal. God wants to care for us. Sometimes we think that it seems like we've got to drag God along to get him to care for us, to do what we pray for. We're asking God, we're seeking God, we're begging, dragging to him. Kind of like my dad. We had a rule in my house on Christmas. Alright? No one was allowed to open presents, nothing, until everybody was in the living room. And of course, when we were young, my sisters and me, we were all geared up for, 4 a.m. in the morning, we're trying to get them up and stuff like that. And Dad became a master at stretching it out as long as he could before he got into that living room. Every Christmas his back hurt, so there's three little kids rubbing his back like crazy, trying to make it feel better for him. They're all rubbing his back and running out of the other. And then, of course, we have to get up, we have to go to the bathroom, we do have to do our routine, our shaving. We get dressed, and then we're pulling him down the hallway. Boy, I gotta get a cup of coffee. And then we're gonna have coffee. And of course, I'm a diabetic, so I'm gonna have a bowl of cereal. I mean, he can stretch that sucker out for an hour, and we're all home bananas. And so often we think that's the way it is with God. And we've got to kind of pull that along. But the truth is, no. The truth is that he does care for us. He really does want to help us, want to grow us, want to love us, want to touch us, want to build our lives. That's the truth. The second truth we talk about is, as Jesus says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give to you. The truth is that God has called us for a purpose. You and I have a purpose. As long as we are breathing, we have a purpose. days during the week, you ever wake up and think, I wonder what God wants me to do today. I wonder what God's purpose for my life today is. To be honest, right? Probably not too often. And yet, that's what God says. The truth is that you and I have a purpose. And that purpose is to bear fruit for God. And every day God lays before you opportunities. Opportunities at work, opportunities at school, opportunities at home, opportunities with your friends. Every day you and I have an opportunity to fulfill the purpose that God has made you. That is the truth. Amen. And every day we can take hold of that. God has a purpose for your life. You are not just here. Third truth I chose to pick is this one. Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive men. You hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not at war. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise up against nation, the kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. And all these are the beginning of the birth pangs. And you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death. And you will be hated by all nations because of me. In a time when many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. That's exactly what we're talking about for last year. We've talked about the persecution that we see across the world. We see it coming to America. We've seen the hatred of people down towards Christianity. You know, Christianity in America is dying. It's a dying religion. There are more people now than ever before in history of America claim that they don't believe as any God. And then when you time to throw the Islam in and the Buddhist and everything else, every year there are less Christians in America than there were the year before. That's the reality. It's exactly what Jesus said is going to happen. And you and I cannot take that lightly. You and I cannot take that lightly. We cannot just stick our head in the sand and assume that it's going to be okay. Not for us, and especially not for our children or our grandchildren. And yet so often we do that, we just automatically assume our kids are going to follow the way we do. We're going to assume that life's going to work out the way we want it to. We're going to assume that we can do what we want. And the reality is we can't anymore. And either we stand for Christ and we live for him, or you'll be lost. No one knows about it. And the truth is that Satan is putting a lot in front of the world today. And we don't have to be alarmed because God told us not to be. God said this is going to happen. So we just don't need to be frightened. We just need to be aware. And we better realize that we can't take God lightly. We can't take our faith lightly. We can't take our views lightly. We can't take the truth lightly. I am the truth. Next one. I am the way. There is only one way. I am it. Jesus says, I am the way. The only way. Not one of ways, not one of many different directions. I am it. There is only one way. There is only one way to get to God. There is only one way to live in this world. There is only one way that works, and I'm it. I am the way for your life, for my life. I am the way. We need to understand that. There is the, you know, you ought to ask Terry what happened the first time, Terry Johnson, the first time he put one of those invisible fences around his house and the dog hit the fence with a little collar on. Okay, he had forgot to adjust it. His dog is like a half a pound, and the thing was set at the highest level. The dog literally flipped three times in the air backwards, ran into the house, and wouldn't go outside for We're like a dog. We're wandering around the yard thinking that we're in control of our life. We're wandering around the yard thinking we go wherever we want. And the truth is that God's got a line. And he says, hey, this is the way. There's a path. If you don't walk it, you're going to get zapped. You're going to get zapped hard. And some of us understand that because we lived without God in our lives for a while. And we know what it means to be empty. And we know what it means to do whatever it takes to feel good for a short period of time. Because as long as I can feel good for a bit, then it's okay. I can make it to the next day. How many people you know live for the weekends? Because then I can have some fun, I can relax. I got to, you know, and then what happens? Monday comes and we're all ready to be bummed out. Life is miserable for me. Yeah. That's not life. I'm surviving to that. I am the way. The only way to live your life is for Christ. As Paul says, for me to live is Christ, die is gain. There's only one way to live our life. Either we're living it for Christ or we're not living. To live for something. is to step out of this life that's meaningless that we do
and live in the power of God.
And it doesn't matter what our past, it doesn't matter how many times we screwed up, because I guarantee you I've screwed up more than any of you. All that matters is that we come. That's all he said. Come. Come to me. Walk to me. Take hold of my truth. I will give you life. Because before Abraham was, I am. We close with a song that celebrates what God is. Hopefully it works. Hit the button again. It doesn't. All right, I'll read you the word. I got it once out of four to work right. Listen to the word. I'm Mark Cho, called I Am. I am the maker of the heaven. I am the bright morning star. I am the breath of all creation, who always was and is to come. I am the one who walked on water. I am the one who calmed the seas. I am the miracles and wonders. So come and see and follow me, and you will know. I am the fount of living water, the risen Son of Man, the healer of the broken. And when you cry, I am your Savior and Redeemer, who bore the sins of man, the author and perfecter, the beginning and the end. I am. I am the Spirit deep inside you. I am the Word upon your heart. I am the one who even knew you before your birth, before you were. Before the earth, I am. The universe, I am. In every heart, I am. Oh, where you are, I am. The Lord of love, I am. The King of kings, I am. The Holy Lamb, I am. Above all things. Yes, I am the Almighty God, your Father, the risen Son of Man, the healer of the broken. And when you cry, I am your Savior and Redeemer, who bore the sins of man, the author and perfecter, the beginning and the end. I am. Amen.
Amen.
Now I may the peace of God which passes all your understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus from this day forward to life everlasting.